Old Testament reading is from Isaiah 63, verses 7 through 9. It's on page 693 in your pew Bibles. I will recount the gracious deeds of the Lord, the praiseworthy acts of the Lord, because of all that the Lord has done for us, and the great favor to the house of Israel that he has shown them, according to his mercy, according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he said, surely they are my people, children who will not deal falsely. And he became their savior, and in all their distress, it was no messenger or angel, but his presence that saved them. In his love and in his pity, he redeemed them. He lifted them up and carried them all the days of old. The New Testament reading is from Matthew chapter 2, verses 13 through 23, and it's on page 2. This is the escape to Egypt. Now after they had left, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, get up, take the child and his mother, and flee to Egypt, and remain there until I tell you. For Herod is about to search for the child, to destroy him. Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother by night, and went to Egypt, and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, out of Egypt I have called my son. When Herod saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, he was infuriated, and he sent and killed all the children in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had learned from the wise men. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah. A voice was heard in Ramah, wailing and loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be consoled, because they are no more. When Herod died, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, get up, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel, for those who were seeking the child's life are dead. Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother, and went to the land of Israel. But when he had heard that Archelaus was ruling over Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. And after being warned in a dream, he went away to the district of Galilee. There he made his home in a town called Nazareth, so what had been spoken through the prophets might be fulfilled. He will be called a Nazarene. God's word.
Grace to you and peace from God our Heavenly Father and His Son Jesus Christ our Lord. Have you noticed the Advent wreath? Last Sunday, all the candles were lit because the culmination of the Advent occurred as we gathered to worship on Christmas Day. There was this immediate tie-in between Advent and Christmas, and now we are in the 12 days of Christmas, well, Christmas time. But today, these attending four candles, they are no longer lit. The only light that prevails is the light that is depicted by the Christ candle. It is as if we regress from a time of joyous celebration on Christmas Day, when the fullness of light has come in Christ, attended to by the prophetic witness throughout Scripture. We have regressed now to a time and only the light of Christ prevails. So too with our Scripture lesson this day. So too as after the joyous celebration of the angelic host, the gathering of shepherds, the coming of kings, and Mary and Joseph and the babe Jesus in the manger, after all of the sentimentality and after all of the joy of Christmas Day, yet again we are plunged into the real world in which we find ourselves. We We are plunged into the real world, where a person like Herod can ascend into a prominence of leadership as a king. We return to a world where, despite all of his incredible improvements to the social structure of the land that he governed, the cistern works, the highways and the byways, the infrastructure accomplishments of Herod, despite all these, when you push the point, he was a despot, he was a tyrant, and he was a person who was intent on doing anything that could be done to retain his power, because for Herod it was always about one thing only: power and Herod. When he hears the news that a Messiah has been born, he begins a conspiracy, an elaborate conspiracy to tease out and the particulars, the knowledge of who this Messiah, this infant child, is, so that he can go and worship him with the sharp edge of a sword. When he doesn't get his way, when he doesn't find out who this child is, this heartless monster, he condones, supports, and authorizes the slaughter of innocents, children under a young age. The armies march in, and if there's a child to be found, it is killed. He will do anything for the sake of power. He is despicable. Fortunately, in this story about one so evil as Herod, there is also a story about one who is good. A good man, righteous in the sight of the Lord, a man named Joseph. Oh yes, he was a good man, a faithful man. He lived to the best of his ability within the constructs of the Jewish legal tradition. But as we read this story, we realize there's something more that sets him apart, something more that adds to the luster of his spiritual death. Joseph listens for the leading of the Lord. Joseph listens and is attentive to the small things of life. And he hears in those small things the still small voice of the Lord, his God. Joseph receives a dream. And just like his namesake, the original patriarch Joseph, he is attentive to that dream. Being warned in the dream, he gets it. He has an elegance and a simplicity combined. He gets it. And being warned in a dream, he takes Mary, his wife, and this infant child, Messiah Jesus, and makes his escape to a foreign land, a land prominent in Scripture, a land called Egypt. Now you would think that if Herod was as powerful as he was, the first thing that he would do as a politician, feeling intimidated and paranoid, the first thing that these guys do, trust me, I have been in such countries, is he would close the borders. He would say, no one comes in, no one gets out. He would close the borders. How then did Joseph arrange for the escape of Joseph, Mary, and Jesus? Well, maybe you've never thought of it before. But what was it that the Magi brought to Jesus? They brought him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. They brought him symbols gifts worthy of a king. And so it's likely that these not only provided for the existence of the family, that holy family, but enabled a bride to be made for him to escape into Egypt. In this simple story of escape from persecution, so much is evoked. There is the fulfillment of all the prophecies in Isaiah about how Jesus will come and go and who he is. There is the fulfillment of the great story of Israel when they come to a time of starvation and famine. They escape because Joseph was sold into bondage and has arisen in Egypt and has the means and the political wherewithal to provide for his entire family despite the evil done against him. It all comes together beautifully in God's plan. It is marvelous and magnificent. So Jesus, born in the promised land of God, escapes just as the people of Israel did before into Egypt to escape the famine. But there's no famine now, is there? Oh, only one famine. He escapes the famine of injustice. He escapes the famine of injustice that would kill him and his life. He escapes the famine of injustice that will slaughter innocent children. He escapes the famine of injustice that is brought about by a person who cares only for himself and is a despicable tyrant. He escapes the famine of injustice. In due course, tyrants die and go away, whether they're named Herod, whether they're named Fidel. In due course, they go away. And Joseph is told he can return now with the holy family back to Israel. But the tyrant's son is just as dangerous. Archelaus is now on the throne. And Joseph decides to go to the Galilee to the north. He goes to a town called Nazareth. The scripture says to fulfill the prophecy that he will be called a Nazarene. There's a problem there. The problem is the scripture doesn't say he's going to be called a Nazarene in the Old Testament. What in the world does it mean to say that he's going to be called a Nazarene? What are we missing in this? Where is there a prophetic substance that would relate to what Jesus lives out in going to Nazareth? Why would he go to a town of 300 people? Why would he go to some place so obscure? Why would he go and be so hidden? Well, if you have Archelaus now breathing down your back, you want to stay on the down low, as they say. The word Nazarene is upon him. There was an order of Nazarene set aside for God's holy use. But the word Nazarene sounds very much like two words. One of these is the word for branch in the Hebrew language. And in Isaiah, it talks about the branch that will come and restore Israel. It's talked about as a splicing of a plant, and a branch is the one that flourishes and still provides life for the ongoing witness of the plant. It might be that. Certainly that was a fulfillment of prophecy. Jesus carries that on in his language when we say in the communion, I am the vine, you are the branches, cut off from me, I mean, you do nothing. So there is that. But there's another word in Hebrew, and that is a word that means hidden and obscure. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? There's no prophecy about Nazareth whatsoever in the scripture. Remember the disciple raising that question? The fulfillment of prophecy is that the Messiah, the Son of God, has to run for his life because of the injustice. And even when he returns, he chooses the most hidden, humble, remote place possible. What a story. How do we appropriate this story as we begin a new year together? Well, we remember Joseph, who had never done only to be a righteous man in his walk before God, but was most righteous because he was attentive to the small things. He listened for the voice of God. He listened for God and expected God to lead him. We can carry that into this new year. We can remember that God leads us sometimes into Egypt, sometimes into the Promised Land, sometimes into Nazareth. But God leads us, and that is enough. And in a world of tyrants, whether they're named Castro, whether they're named Putin, whether they're named somebody in Syria or North Korea, wherever they may be, we are not them. For we follow the Prince of Peace, and we follow the one who is Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, who will not allow the tyrant to succeed. We follow the one who is about justice. But he who has ears to hear, hear the word of the Lord. And may God bless us and keep us in this new year. Amen.